Welcome back, everyone, to the lecture about applied bioimage analysis. This part will be about ImageJ macro programming, and I will start with the simple stuff first. So we will talk about variables and operations, and some of the material is shared amongst colleagues here on campus. So Benoit, Gayathri, Jens, and Noreen, we are working together with many others actually in the Biopolis Dresden imaging platform, and we are sharing some teaching material, and I'm happy that we do so. Because otherwise, each of us would have a lot more work actually. So this session will be about how to analyze individual images in a script, so that we can get a measurement out, for example, and that we don't have to do in case of video processing the processing for every frame by hand. Because as soon as we are talking about 100 frames, and it's or 10 frames already, that's no longer doable. Right, so we have to program that, or we have to formalize our workflow in a way that we can apply the same workflow to many images. Before we start, so during this lecture, I would actually expect you to click on pause from time to time and to try out what I'm demonstrating, because that's, I think that's the way you learn the easiest way. And therefore, you can also use our cheat sheet. So we started that some years ago, and it's now maintained by many people, so we try to put the most important information about ImageJ macro on just two sheets of paper. You can print out, you can put next to your computer, and then you will see many of the things I'm now talking about on the next slides. You will see on this cheat sheet as well, and that might help you when programming. So before we start actually learning a new programming language, let's think a bit about how programming works. And it might be, sure, it might be trivial for people who programmed already. For those who are just starting to program or who programmed a long time ago, this slide is meant to make you less afraid of what's coming now. Let's talk about the algorithm which solves the scientific problem of eating a banana. Thanks to Claudio Duran, by the way, who had this amazing idea during the course last year. And so first of all, the first step for eating a banana is you remove the shell. And then you repeat several steps a couple of times. For example, you take a bite, you chew, and you swallow. And again, you repeat this for a couple of times, and then you start digesting the banana. Let's think about that in a little bit more technical way. So let's assume we have a data set of a banana acquired with a magnetic resonance imaging. And how could we process this data set? So let's assume we have for every slice of the banana, we have a TIFF file in the folder, and we want to do some measurements on these images slice by slice. So yeah, the first step is we have to access the folder in order to find out how many files are in there. And then we repeat for all files in that folder, for all of these images, we repeat, okay, we open the image file, we segment the banana slice, we do an image segmentation, a thresholding, right? And then we analyze it. And after we have done that for all the images in the folder, we save the measurements in a table to disk, right? And this is how the ImageJ macro code for that looks like. So yes, it is a new language. Yes, it looks a little bit weird. But it's in colors that helps us reading it. So these colors are part of the story. It's not like somebody put their random colors on top. And we can actually, with some experience, with some training, so training, trying out, doing it again and again is the way to learn this. We can actually read this thing, this piece of code. We can read it like that. So, and we will practice over and over, and by the end of the semester, for sure, you will be able to do this on a basic level, right? We don't want to write big programs which do fancy stuff. We want to analyze images. We want to go through a folder with images and apply the same filtering, thresholding, analysis to all the images in the folder, and that's what we want to do. I don't want you to become software developers, right? Okay, the very first thing which is important in ImageJ macro is variables. So variables can hold values and can be connected by operators. And it's as simple as that, that you can write something like a equals 1, b equals 2.5. You can do math, so by, for example, saying, okay, I will now make a new variable which is called final result, and I will put the sum of a and b into it, And last but not least, in order to see if the program worked as we wanted to have it, we can also print values. So if you execute this little program, you find it in the examples folder. You don't have to type it from the YouTube video, right? You find it in the example folder next to the slides. And if you execute this program, it will print out this 3.5. There are some mathematical operations here. It's just a selection in case you need them at some point. They are also in cheat sheet, right? So you can calculate the power, the square root, the absolute value. You can round numbers, stuff like that. And you already saw them, you can put comments in your code. And actually, especially for beginners, I strongly recommend to put comments in code. Because if a program looks like this simple one I just showed you, sure, you will in half a year still be able to read what this program is doing. But as soon as programs become more complicated, you will need comments in there. And that has nothing to do with your expert level. And that's also true for the people who do programming for decades, right? So if you want to quickly read a program you wrote half a year ago, you will need good comments in between sections or at particular lines to find out what this program is doing, because the comments are written in human language, the program is not. So what kind of comments should you actually put into your code? So one of the very first comments, which is unfortunately missing in many, many cases you find out there, is you should put in the very first lines of your script, you should put a comment what this program does. Because instead of reading these 150 lines which are now coming, you could just read this one sentence telling you what these 150 lines of code are doing. So please, put in the first line of your code, put a comment explaining what this program does. Secondly, how can it be used? If you find a program which ends with the file ending .py or .ijm, so what do you do with it? Where do you have to put it? What do you have to install? And right, so these are the kind of the important things you should put in comments. You should definitely put your name there and, for example, also an email address, maybe also a date to remind yourself when this was happening. So for example, I wrote this little script 4 years ago, and if somebody finds it on the internet, they can send me an email and say, Robert, we would like to use your script in a scientific project where we want to add two numbers. And they can communicate with you, right? Otherwise, they may use your code and they may use it in a wrong way. And then later on, you find out that other scientists are using your code and they are using it in the wrong way. It's like, you put your name there, put your email address there, and then this problem is gone. Furthermore, that's the important point for comments within your code. You should write in comments additional information which is not in the code itself. So you should always describe what is happening and why, and not just writing what is already there. So for example, do not comment what is obvious. So if the command is called print final result, that's what this line here says, right? A comment above print final result is not necessary. It's then actually too much documentation, which makes it again harder to read. So only put additional new information where the reader can take something from it, and don't write the obvious. There's a new thing we recently developed, and hopefully it's helpful for you, especially for beginners who want to learn programming. You may want to take notes in a nice to read way. So you can program in a macro like this. That's a similar program like just before. I have two variables. I print out one of the variables, then I calculate the sum and I print out the sum. And I wrote here in between with a different way of writing comments. I wrote in between some text explaining what it's doing. It always starts with star slash and it ends with star slash. And in between you can put headlines. You can also put bullet points, links, descriptive stuff in this format, right? And when you run this in a particular way, it's explained here on this website, you get a website out where you can read the same text as it is over here in a nicer to read way. So you may want to write, especially at the beginning, when still learning and still explaining code to yourself, you can write the code like this. You can generate this this website, and you can save this website as PDF to the folder where you take the notes for this semester. That may be helpful, so try it out. So far we dealt only with numeric values in our variables, right? 1 and 2, and we can sum them, and then we have a variable holding the value 3. You can also do the same thing with strings. Strings is text, which you find between quotas. And for example, you have here two variables, first name and last name, and they contain my name. And if you want to concatenate them, if you want to sum them, I mean, the plus symbol is used here, but we are actually concatenating them. We can combine my first name and my last name to my name. If we would do that, they would be sticking to each other. And in order to prevent the sticking, we put a space in between, because that's how we people put our names, right? First name, space, last name. And I know that is complicated for you when you just start programming to read this kind of text, and it will also be a little bit more complicated in the future. So plus quota, space, quota, plus. But it comes by training. So if you do that a couple of times, it will be no issue at all. It's just like at the beginning, maybe a bit complicated to read things like that. Plus, quota, exclamation mark, quota, brackets, semicolon. Yes, that's not human language. But again, by doing it a couple of times, you will get used to it. Furthermore, in order to understand programs in a better way, many software environments like Fiji use colors to visualize code in a better readable way. So these colors are meant for you to make the code easier readable. So you have seen already that comments are written in green. So if you just roughly want to know what the program is doing, you scroll through it and you only read the green text. Commands and actions are yellow, and numbers and texts are written in pink or violet. And as soon as you hit a part in the program where the color doesn't fit your expectation, then you may realize that there is something wrong. So let's execute this program, and we get an error message. So it tells us that in line number 9, at the beginning of line number 9, there might be something wrong. We now look at the beginning of line number 9 and we realize there is nothing. And this error message is pointing us to the print statement in line number 8. So unfortunately, the line number is a little bit wrong. And that happens. This program was also just written by a human. Furthermore, it points at the beginning of the line, and that often might mean that actually in the line before there is something happening or something wrong. So it points us here. Also, where the color is not fitting, there is maybe something wrong. And in this particular case, when you look at it, there is a quota symbol missing here. Even though the error message tells us that there is a bracket missing. So the error message tries to help us. It roughly points us where the issue is. We have to read it carefully that it is expecting something somewhere close by the print statement, somewhere close by line number 9. And then we have to roughly look into the region of the code where the problem actually is. It is not always exactly the line where it's pointing to, and it's sometimes expecting a different character than it actually tells us. And reading error messages is an absolutely normal thing, right? It's not like, oh my God, we did something wrong and then we have to escape. No, reading error messages is the thing the programmer does every day. So, and you will become a little bit a programmer during this semester. Okay, learning by doing. Let's do this. So in my Fiji window, I just click on New Script. And then the script editor opens, which should approximately look like that. And I will now try some super simple things out. Maybe I also increase the font. So let's define two variables, A equals 5 and B equals 7. And you see already that I'm making typos all day, and that's fine. And let's calculate the sum of both and print it out. If we hit the run button now, there's the first error message coming up, and it tells us what to do. We have to select the language first, and we will select for today ImageJ macro. And if we now run this program, it tells us that there's a number or numeric function expected in line number 6. And line number 6, this time the line number is correct, right? It tells us that there is here before this bracket. That's what these smaller and larger than signs tell us. There's something missing between these brackets. Yeah, sure. I want to print something out and I forgot to specify what to print out. So let's print out C, the sum we just calculated. And this program tells us it's 12. 5 plus 7. Then we put some additional comments into it, like calculate the sum and define some variables. And then we have actually already written our first good program, right? What I showed you earlier, what you can also do is use this different way of writing it. And you see, I'm moving around code by copy-paste. You don't have to, but sometimes it makes life easier. And if you then switch the language to ImageJ Macro Markdown and you execute your program again, there's some additional windows popping up, like the browser in this case, which delivers this website I was telling you about. So maybe this helps you in preparing a nice to read document where you document how you learn programming in ImageJ Macro step by step. Let's now try the same thing with strings. So again, my first name is Robert. My last name is actually pronounced Hase. And let's put my name together. And you see already there is sometimes this window popping up, the auto-completion window. And this auto-completion window helps me writing the variables in the correct way. So I sometimes do typos, so I would now maybe write first name where the A is missing or something like that. That cannot happen if I just hit enter here and now. So I started entering the variable name first name, and I now click on enter and it's completing the name. So that makes my life easier, right? So I don't have to type so much and the likelihood of doing typos goes down. But in order to realize that this thing is happening, we have to sometimes look, okay, what is this suggesting here? So it's suggesting last name, and last name is a user-defined variable in line number 2. Nico De Francesco was programming this part, by the way. So, and therefore I have to look into this pull-down from time to time, right? Furthermore, I can print out my name. Yeah, and you can also navigate with the up and down keys here to pick a variable which you want to enter here in this particular field. So, and then we can run also this program. Maybe I switch back to the macro language so that not the browser is popping up all the time. And you can see it's putting together robot semicolon Hase. Where is this semicolon coming from? That's actually weird. And when we go up in our code, we see, okay, there is a string which is supposed to be pink, but it's not pink. So I forgot the quota symbol here. And for the moment, you also see that there is a semicolon by the end of the line. I'm putting semicolons by the end of every line because that's necessary in the ImageJ Macro language. Let's see, some lines work without semicolons, some others don't. I will just leave it out for a second and see what if it's working. So this one is working. Maybe later on I forget to put a semicolon somewhere and we will get an error message and then I can show you how it looks like. What you see now is that Robert and Hase are sticking to each other, and that's why I can actually add another space in here. That's what I said earlier. In order to generate proper text, so now there is a space in between, we have to put these operations. And putting strings together in such a way is very important, especially, for example, when you think about paths and file names, because sometimes you have to put a slash in between in order to show that you mean a file in a folder. So this is something that happens in the exercise today or next week, which happens to some students, and that's why I'm saying sometimes if the file cannot be found, there may just be a slash missing between file name and path. Furthermore, what's also kind of interesting is playing with numbers and strings in one program. So let's make a variable A. And we say the variable A contains a zero in quota. So this is a text. This is not a number. And we make a variable B and we say it will equal 1. And now we make a new variable and we add these two values to each other. And we print it out to see what it's doing. Yeah. So it is concatenating the 0 and the 1. It is not adding the number 0 plus the number 1, because this is actually not a number. It's a string which contains a number. I would like to show you some other trick which might be helpful, especially when learning this new programming language. When we use print, you find here in the auto-completion pulldown that it's actually suggesting some different ways of printing. So this is the print we used so far. So print and a string in brackets, and we will output something to the log window. So this auto-completion window explains us a bit what these commands are doing we are using. And if you wonder how print works, you can look this up here in this little window. And there is a special print statement. It's called print clear, which will empty the log window. So this window you saw here, it's like new putting new stuff in, and at some point it becomes very long, and it may be harder to read and see what it's actually doing. That's why let's print clear at the very beginning of our program to then only see this one line in there. And when I execute this, the window is cleared at the very beginning, then we do our math, and then we can print out the result of our math. And later you will have an exercise where you have to do some math, where you have to write down an equation for calculating something. And when you do this and when you try to learn this, maybe it's helpful to put this print clear command at the very beginning to see a bit what it's doing. Okay, that's the first part. We will start with the second part in a minute. See you soon.